I'm 22 years old, fresh out of college, and I recently got a job at my old high school as a sort of computer intern in the school basement. The basement of the school is very messy and disorganized, but there is a small three-person office that's actually very nice down there. It has three nice big desks, two mini fridges, a flat-screen TV mounted on the wall, and oh-so-satisfying air conditioning, a luxury the students and teachers cannot enjoy in the school. And of course, all the school servers and other computery stuff. I got the job because three of my old computer teachers flat out adored me. I could actually consider them as real friends, not just teacher figures. So they all helped tremendously in landing me this job. It's been great. Until something that happened a few weeks ago. My two co-workers that shared the office with me, Dave and Gary, weren't in the office at the time. They were upstairs working on papers or whatever. I was eating my sandwich during my lunch break when I got a phone call from one of the women in the front office telling me the school was on lockdown and that somebody, possibly armed, had entered the school. There wasn't much that I could do other than turn off the lights because, surprisingly, as nice as this little office was, it didn't have an actual door to it, just a big opening, and the door to the whole basement didn't even have a working lock. For my own safety, I did turn off all the lights in the office and my computer screen. I kept my phone on the desk, texting both Gary and Dave, but they wouldn't respond. I sat down there in the dark, playing games on my phone for like 20 minutes. Waiting for the call from up front to tell me to resume working. I had no idea what was happening, I couldn't hear what was going on upstairs from down here. But I was not allowed to make any calls until I was informed that the lockdown was over. Then, the noisy basement door opened. As the creaking echoed across the basement and into my office, I sat up from my seat, wondering if I should call out Gary or Dave. I was eager to get some info from them. Someone then came running down the stairs, and their footsteps were approaching my office. I pushed away my chair and crawled under my desk. Somebody entered the office, but did not turn on the lights. There was just silence. I can't even describe the fear I was experiencing. I felt like if I made one sudden noise, I'd be a dead man. Suddenly, my phone dinged as I got a text message. I felt my entire world shrivel up and die at that one moment, as I clenched my teeth in fear. Footsteps suddenly moved closer to me, until I finally dove out from under the desk in capitulation, begging whoever it was not to kill me. And just then, someone grabbed my arm and pulled me up. It was some guy in a red plaid button-up, jeans, and a reddish-black cap. He told me, "It's okay, I'm just down here hiding with you." "What's going on up there?" I whispered to him. He kind of ignored my question and asked me if there's an exit down here. I told him, "Yeah, around that way." Before he could do anything else, I asked him, "Who are you?" There was a brief moment of silence. Before he started explaining, he was coming in to pick up his son when a teacher told him to hide. After his explanation, I checked my phone and saw the text I received was from Dave. It said,
"Dude, this is fucking crazy. Some guy with a gun shot Mr. Buckley. He's wearing a red shirt and a hat. Whatever you do, don't come upstairs."
I was about to reread that text out loud to the man, until I realized. I looked up, and felt my stomach sink. The man seemed to catch on to my suspicious stare. Panicking, all I could think to do was to run for the upstairs. A gunshot echoed through the basement, and I could hear the bullet ricochet off something metal in the darkness. But thank God the bullet missed me, and I made it upstairs. Fortunately, police were waiting at all exits, including the basement exit, and caught the man the second he opened the door. More good news, our teacher Mr. Buckley survived the gunshot. It was later determined that the man and Mr. Buckley had some beef for whatever reason, but that was never revealed. All we know is that Mr. Buckley couldn't have done anything that would have warranted this kind of reaction. And I know that the sound of that gunshot will forever echo in my mind. It was approaching the end of summer, and my friends and I wanted to do some cool, mischievous things before going back to school. So, we had the genius idea one night to sneak into a nearby community pool. It was actually only a couple blocks away. It's right smack in the middle of a residential area, so instead of sitting on a main road or something, it actually just sat around a bunch of houses on a quiet road. During a hot day, the little parking lot would be full and the spot would be bustling. But at 1 in the morning, the place was of course dead. There's obviously a big fence surrounding the whole front entrance, as well as a cage that gets closed up when the place closes, so our best way was to get in through the side. We snuck into the backyard of a neighboring house and hopped the fence over to the pool. It was as easy as that. The four of us took off our shirts and jumped into the pool, which in retrospect wasn't smart, since any of the neighbors could have heard the splashes and just called the police. But we were dumb high schoolers. It was very, very dark within that hole enclosing. This pool had no lights, which is why it closed at sunset. James, Courtney, and Alyssa were on the other side of the pool as I was just kind of doing my own thing at first, swimming around and getting my face wet. I saw Alyssa get out of the pool shortly after and run away. I swam over to see what was going on. She was just going to the water fountain, though. The three of us just bopped around in the water for a bit, and eventually we heard Alyssa jump back into the pool from the other side. It was too dark to see much more than her black hair covering her face. But just then we heard Alyssa playfully call something to us as she was walking back to the pool. The three of us in the pool looked at each other. I know they were doing the same thing as me, counting heads. There were three of us on this side of the pool, and here came Alyssa walking over to our side. So who was that on the other side? Alyssa got in, but the three of us were distracted, looking at the head bopping around the water across the pool. James said across the pool, "Who is that?" Not even 2 seconds later, the head went underwater and disappeared from view. We took this time to whisper to each other, mostly things like, "What should we do? What if that's security? And should we run?" Suddenly, I felt something grab my leg with force and tried pulling me down into the water. I kicked, splashed, and yelled for help. James came over to pull me out of the pool, while the girls were already running for it, screaming. It wasn't until I got to the stairs of the pool that the grip on my leg was released and I was free. We hopped the same fence we climbed over to get in and ran all the way back to Alyssa's house. I was convinced that whoever that was a security guard. That is, until they literally tried to pull me under the water. We don't know what to think. There are a few possibilities. Maybe it was just another kid messing with us, maybe it was a security guard who went way too far, or most likely, it was a dangerous person who had ill intent. So this happened a few months ago. I'm 26. I was at JFK Airport in New York with 5 friends. All of us were about to fly down to Florida to spend the week in a beach house. We had a few more minutes to kill in the airport before we would board our flight, and I really had to go to the bathroom all of a sudden. I was baffled to see a line out the door for the bathroom. I noticed a janitor walking by, so I asked her if there was another bathroom nearby that wouldn't be so crowded. She laughed and told me she shouldn't really be telling people, but there was another bathroom past a door she was pointing at, down a narrow flight of stairs and to the left. I thanked her because she was extremely nice and followed the direction she gave me. Sure enough, behind that door that no one would think to open was a small stairway that led down to a really poorly lit, skinny hallway. It was so narrow that if 2 people were to pass by each other, 1 person would have to stand against the wall to make room. I found the bathroom right away. The door was extremely heavy and hard to push. Also, the lights were on inside of the bathroom, and it was filthy in there. It was evident that nobody ever really came in there to clean. Now, this is a little embarrassing to mention, but when I go to the bathroom in public places, I always try to make sure nobody else is around to possibly hear me going. So after checking the stall to see that it was unoccupied, I went back into the hallway for a second to take a look down both directions. To the left, there was somebody standing at the end of the hall, in a dark, unlit section of the hallway. It was a disturbing sight to say the least. All I could do was awkwardly pull my head back into the bathroom and try to pretend we didn't see each other. I went into the stall and just stood there biting my fingers for a minute, dreading the thought of that door opening. And of course, it did. I saw the man's black shoes under the stall door as he walked to the stall next to mine. He shut the door, and then there was silence. No sound of the man unzipping his fly or sitting down, nothing. I realized I didn't really have to go anymore, and went to unlock the stall door. That's when I looked up, and saw the man's head peering over the stall, looking at me. I nearly had a heart attack as my screams bounced off the walls of the tiny bathroom. I ran back up those damn steps and out that door, and then casually walked back over to my friends. I was breathing heavily, but nobody seemed to notice. I didn't tell anyone, just because it was embarrassing, and I didn't want my friends to make fun of me in any way. I know, I guess that seems stupid now. We went on to have our Florida vacation and all had a good time. Of course, the thought of that creepy man haunted me every night that week. This is a short but terrifying story of something that happened when I was Snapchatting a friend. I'm pretty young, I'm only 13, still in middle school. A girl I really liked had just recently started snapping me selfie pictures, and we started messaging each other for a few nights. One night when I was watching TV, she sent me a snap of herself laying in her bed without a caption. I sent a message saying, "What's up?" She sent another identical picture, this time with a caption saying, "Not much, you?" She set the timer to 10 seconds, so it gave me plenty of time to analyze the picture, including her bedroom in the background, and the dark outline of a person standing by her window. I quickly sent a response message, saying, "Is that your brother by the window?" She sent another identical snap, this time captioned, "What do you mean?" In this picture, the figure at the window was closer, and I could see a hand pressed up against the glass. I closed the snap before the timer even ran out so I could tell her quicker. I said, "There's somebody at your window, turn around." She opened my snap almost immediately, and then I didn't hear from her again on the app. I grew more and more worried as the minutes passed. I texted her a few times to no avail. I tried calling her a few times to no avail as well. I didn't know her house phone number, otherwise I would have called her parents. It wasn't until midnight when I was already laying in bed that she finally texted me back. She explained the whole situation. As soon as she looked at her window and saw the person standing there, she screamed. And that caused the person, who turned out to be a 20-something-year-old man, to open the window and jump into the room. From there, she ran to her parents' room and woke her dad, who went to her room to find nothing but an open window. It wasn't exactly a personal story of mine, but it freaks me out nonetheless, knowing that the only thing that saved my friend from whatever could have happened was the fact that I was able to see the window through her selfies, unbeknownst to the creeper at her window.
This happened about 5 years ago when I was 21. Me and my friend Seth got into this app which showed you ghosts. We'd go out ghost hunting, but nothing much would happen. Sometimes a dot would appear on one of our phones and it would say random words. We would ask, "How did you die?" and stuff like that. And sometimes the answers lined up, but it was mostly random. One night, around 2 a.m., Seth suggested going to the cemetery to see if the app picked anything up. I was hesitant, but I nervously agreed. We started making our way through the neighborhood towards the cemetery. It was weird as the streets are normally lined with cars, but they were empty on this night. We walked down the middle of the road with the app running, but it wasn't picking anything up. We finally made it to the cemetery, which was a small, family-owned one where they only buried their own. Seth went up to the gate and started shouting, hoping to get a response on the app, but nothing happened. I was standing in the road, feeling unsettled, when Seth starts yelling,
"Is that all you've got?"
I told him to stop disrespecting the dead and we should leave. He tried being funny, saying,
"Oh, I'll make him show up."
And jumped the gate and started stomping on the graves while screaming,
"Come on, show us something."
All of a sudden, our phone said something at the same time. I looked down at my phone and it was there. We both just stood there, looking at each other when 10 or so red dots appeared on the radar, and it said it again. When I looked back up from my phone, Seth was next to me. I said,
"We have got to go."
As soon as I said that, we could hear the street lights turning off one by one from the top of the street, getting closer to us. We took off running as fast as we could. We got about halfway into the neighborhood before running out of breath and having to stop. I felt like I was gonna throw up from being scared and winded. Then I heard my phone say something. It was muffled, but I knew what it said. Being too scared to look at my phone, I looked at Seth, who looked terrified. He nodded at me to get my phone out, so I slowly pulled it out and it said my name across the top. I turned my phone off and said,
"Screw this, I'm done."
We made our way back to my house and had a cigarette to calm down. We were talking about what just happened, almost not believing it, when I heard my phone again. This time, it was my sister's name. We just stood there, frozen, not saying a word, when it went off again and said my brother's name. I took my phone out, turned it on, and deleted the app. I asked Seth to stay the night, but he refused. I can't blame him. When I finally got to sleep that night, I dreamt a muffled voice repeating a word over and over. I started to wake up and the words became clearer. My phone was off, with the battery out. But when I turned it over, it was lit up with the app running. It had a red dot about 6 feet from me, still repeating. I woke up the next morning and went to the bathroom. I had a razor-thin cut from my left shoulder to my right hip. I don't know what happened that night, and nothing has happened to me since. Needless to say, I don't mess with that kind of stuff anymore.
The origins of the Sunny family cult, which is known as one of the most mysterious murder cults in American history, can be traced back to April Fool's Day, 1982. The last reported Sunny killing was in 2015 in the northern Iowa town of Bettendorf.
Crazy thing is, they're still out there.
Whatever, it's just an urban legend they tell kids so they don't do anything crazy on April Fool's.
No, my parents actually told me it was real.
Well, if I was that guy, I would've just killed them all. It's why you carry a gun on you guys.
Dude, what are you talking about? You don't own a gun.
Yeah, guns are super lame anyway.
No, you're right. Yeah. Guns are lame. Good thing, though, I don't need a gun to protect you, though.
Yeah, no.
So, truth or dare, guys?
Ooh!
No.
Ooh, can I go first?
Can
I go first?
That's so lame.
No, let's do it.
Okay. I'll go first. Taylor. Truth or dare?
Dare.
I dare you to do 7 minutes of heaven with me.
You don't have to do that.
No, it's fine. I want to. I swear.
Okay.
Whoa, you're pretty aggressive.
You know, I actually like you. I'm not just trying to get you.
Stop lying, okay? Just shut up. Sorry.
Well, this game sucks.
He's dead. That's not even funny. I think it is.
Aaron, this isn't cool, man. He's dead. He's really dead. Oh, God! Dude, what is going on?
No idea.
Oh, shit! Jessa! Oh my God! Dude, we gotta fucking go! We gotta go! Fuck! Shit! Dude, we need to get the fuck out of here! Taylor has lost her mind!
It's just so much fucking fun, though. It just sucks. Because you are kind of cute. I feel bad, too. You were, like, the only cool one, and you're so nice.
I'm still the cool one.
What if you joined us? We're like a family. People say it's a cult, but it's more of a family. We could have so much fun together. Plus, I know you like me.
I do. I really do like you.
I know you do.
Taylor, we gotta go get the cops. We can fix this. This will be fine.
What a bummer.
Taylor, I told you, strangle, don't stab. You never listen.
stabbing's so much more fun, though.
Looks like we are gonna need a lot more bleach.
I did good, though, right?
You did good. You're a real part of the family now, honey.
You know what? I think we should do a family portrait.
Over the weekend, about 15 co-workers and myself had our company trip to the Stanley Hotel in Estes Park, known for being Stephen King's inspiration for The Shining. We took an 8 p.m. ghost tour where we joined about 15 other people to get guided around the property and told stories about its history and creepy things that are said to have happened. We were told to take a lot of pictures, I'm sure to try and capture orbs or ghosts. Many green orbs were caught in pictures, but I don't think anything is as creepy as this photo taken by my coworker. A little girl in a hot pink dress who was definitely not on our tour. And apparently, years ago, a young girl who was 12 to 13 by the name of Lucy was squatting in the basement of the concert hall, which is where this photo was taken, and she was discovered upon plans to begin some construction. She was forced to leave, and the night got below freezing, so she froze to death. Everyone on my tour has vouched that this girl was not on our tour. I mean, who wouldn't remember someone wearing hot pink? The man pictured is our tour guide. No one would have been in front of him. I am convinced that this is the ghost of Lucy. Just one more added note, though I doubt anyone would believe me. But there was only one time throughout the tour where I felt any strange energy or feeling, and it was right there, headed down to the basement of the concert hall.
This happened a few weeks ago when I was walking home from school, excited that my freshman year was coming to an end. It was a Tuesday night when I was turning in my last essay for history. I left it to the last minute, and the teacher actually made me complete it before I could go home. I hated my teacher for that. Around 8 p.m., I had finished that goddamn essay and was walking home. The rain had stopped and there was a beautiful sunset. Suddenly, I noticed something. There was a red 2016 Toyota Camry right behind me. I got goosebumps thinking it was following me. I didn't look back and started walking in my apartment's direction. I wanted to go to a busy road to feel safer. Just then, the car sped up, stopping right next to me. A middle-aged man asked me where I was headed and suggested to drop me off. I said no thanks, but the man wouldn't leave and insisted. I wanted to tell the man to just fuck off, but I took off running instead. I heard a loud noise and at the same time felt something I can only describe as a sharp vibration hitting my flesh. I fell to the ground, not knowing what happened. Out of adrenaline, I was about to get up and run again as I felt a heavy arm grab me by the mouth. Then the pain set in. I realized that I was shot. There was another man next to him that searched my pockets. He grabbed my phone and threw it on the ground as he tied my legs and taped my mouth. They quickly put me into the trunk of their car and then started driving. I could feel that we were going very fast, and I'm sure that we hadn't stopped at all for a good 30 minutes. I was feeling my blood soaking into my shirt, which scared me the most. I was certain that I was going to die. I was thinking about my parents and what they would feel when they heard that I was missing. Then the car came to a stop. By some miracle, I heard a police officer asking for IDs and driver's licenses. I wanted to yell for help, but nothing came out. Just then, I heard 3 to 4 gunshots. I heard another cop yelling,
"Man down! Man down! Shots fired!"
I was begging the cop to find me. Then I heard the cop searching the car. I was feeling joy as my pain was growing worse. Seconds felt like hours. The officer then opened the car's trunk and suddenly started firing at me out of a fight or flight response. Thankfully, the bullets missed. The officer quickly caught up to the fact that I was kidnapped and injured. He called for backup immediately, and it arrived in minutes. They placed the injured officer onto a gurney and drove off in an ambulance. Finally, when the scene was safe, they called another ambulance for me. I woke up in the hospital. The news media was everywhere. I was fine after a few days, but later learned that the officer that was shot didn't make it. I don't know if those men are still alive, or rotting away in a prison for killing an officer. I don't want to know what would have happened if those officers hadn't stopped the car.
Black as coal.
Carrie, we've been watching for like an hour. Are you sure this is the way?
She knows where she's going, Ben.
Brutes, go back in the hole and spare the living one more soul.
Stop it, Mats. Should we really be doing this? There's a reason the story tells us to stay away from it, right?
Carrie's dad is in the high order, Ben. I think she would know.
Carrie.
Probably just the story, Ben. Don't pee your pants again.
Whoa.
Who's going to open it?
Okay. I knew he wouldn't do it.
Hey, Ben, Carrie said she'd give you a kiss if you do it.
Shut up, Max. No, I didn't.
She tried.
Maybe if you're nice enough, it'll just open by itself.
Yeah, Ben, did you try asking it?
Yeah, please, Brute, come out of your hole and beat the living black as coal.
Are you going to open it?
What the?
This happened when I was 17 years old. I would go to the gym 3 to 4 times a week and ride the bus home. It was a Sunday and I had just missed my bus, so I had to wait longer for another one. I would have called my parents, but they were out for the evening, and taxis charged more, so I decided to sit and wait in the bus shelter. It was a cold night and snow had just started peppering the ground. My bus was taking longer than usual, so I got my phone out and listened to some music. Almost an hour had passed. It was freezing and I hadn't seen anyone at all. That was until I noticed something out of the corner of my eye. It was a creepy guy dressed in thick layers of clothing, walking slowly towards me. I knew staring at him would draw more attention, so I just focused on my phone. He sat down at the other end of the shelter and just stared at me. There was something off about him. He seemed like he was either drunk or on drugs. He then asked,
"What does the bus do?"
I took out my earphones and said,
"I think it's delayed, because of the snow."
He stared at me for a while, then started mumbling to himself. He was really starting to creep me out, so I pretended to be on my phone. After a couple of minutes, I took another look. He'd moved closer to me. I looked away for a second, then heard the sound of him sliding even closer. I turned to him and said,
"You okay there?"
He stared at me with glossy eyes, lifted his arm, and leaned towards me. Immediately, I grabbed my bag and ran as he fell to the ground. I ran down the road, trying my hardest not to look back. I kept going until I got to the next bus stop. I turned around to check to see if he was there. He was gone, so I went to sit down. Feeling relieved, I rested my head on the back of the glass and waited for the bus. I jolted and turned around to see the same guy staring at me through the glass.
"What the hell is wrong with you?"
Then he started walking around the shelter towards me.
"I'm warning you, stay back!"
I yelled in panic as I was backing up. I wanted to run, but I left my bag in the shelter and I couldn't leave without it. Suddenly, the man leaped at me and I quickly moved out of the way. He fell to the ground face first. I froze in shock, then noticed the blood coming from his face. I tried to get a response out of him, but nothing worked. I called the police and paramedics, and they arrived shortly after. I told them what had happened, and they told me that the guy was on prescription drugs. They found a photo in his wallet of him and his son. The boy looked just like me, so we assumed he thought I was him. I later learned that he had lost his son in a custody battle and went off the rails. He was taken away for treatment. That was the last I saw of him. I got my driver's license shortly after, and have never been on a bus since. It was November of 2006. I was a 16-year-old kid living in the town of Altoona, Iowa. I went to bed early one night because I had to work the early shift at McDonald's. As I slept, I had a dream that I was running through downtown Des Moines. But I wasn't on a jog, I was running from something. As I ran around the corner of a building, I came face to face with my pursuer. A tall man wearing a trench coat and a top hat stood in front of me. The only thing visible of his face was his eyes. They were abnormally large with black pupils, and it looked at me as if it wanted something. After what felt like hours, he reached out his bony hand, as if he wanted me to go with him. I woke up violently from my dream, and after catching my breath, I peered around my room to see if I was safe. As I stood up from my bed, I noticed that I could see my breath. Feeling confused, I checked my window. It was latched shut. I then walked over and checked my vent. I could still feel warm air coming from it. As I sat back down on my bed, I tried to figure out what exactly was going on. That's when the figure from my dream appeared at the foot of my bed. I scrambled back to my headboard.
"What do you want?"
I asked, trying to hide the shakiness in my voice. With the same bony finger, it pointed at me. Growing up in a religious home, I believed what I was looking at was a demon. I told the creature to leave. It just waved its finger at me, and with a low voice, it spoke to me.
Never leave. Always here.
The creature then screamed loudly and disappeared. A feeling of nausea came over me, and I vomited on my floor. The last thing I remember was cleaning myself up and waking up to my alarm. It's been about a month since I had seen the top hat-wearing man in my bedroom. The Christmas season was in full effect. My parents weren't home because they got invited to some kind of event. So it was only me and my three sisters at home. I had to wake up early in the morning for work, so I decided to go to sleep. I rested my head on my pillow and closed my eyes. Not even 30 seconds passed until my sisters burst into my room and started singing obnoxious songs. This, of course, made me very angry, but I thought if I ignored them that they would leave me alone. This was not the case. As I pulled the blankets over my head, I started to feel the same cold feeling that I had in November. As the obnoxious singing subsided, I lowered the blanket below my eyes and saw the man standing in the corner of my room. In one swift motion, he charged towards me, and I blacked out. When I finally came to, I found that my sisters had locked themselves inside the bathroom. As I knocked on the door, they told me to go away. I asked them what happened, and all they could say was Mom and Dad were on their way home. I looked down and saw that my hand was slightly bloody. Holes were in the bathroom door, and a broom was sticking out of the wall. I then walked into the living room and found that there were knives stuck into the wall as well. The same wave of nausea passed over me, just like in November, and I threw up again. As I was cleaning up, my parents walked through the door. My father immediately walked over to me and gave me a good beating. Then he sent me to my room. I went to bed crying. Not from the beating. I was crying because of the confusion. I had no idea what was going on. The next morning, my sisters reluctantly sat next to me and told me what had happened. They said I got angry and chased them down and tried to hurt them. They said my eyes were red to the point where they thought I was bleeding from them. They said I sounded like a different person. In 2011, that was the last time I saw the top hat wearing man. I just moved into a new apartment, and after a long, stressful day of unpacking, I took a shower and got ready for bed. As I started to drift off, I could feel that cold feeling again. I lifted my head and saw the man standing in front of me. The man's eyes were red now. With a low voice, just like on that November night, it looked at me and said,
"Never leave. Always here."